Hi, this is Anne. I won't appear on camera very often this semester. Personally, I'm not real comfortable with it, and I think it's distracting. Normally, when I'm doing a recorded tutorial like this, I'll be sharing my screen and talking. But I think right here at the beginning of a semester, it's a little weird for me to be just a disembodied voice. And so I wanted to basically spend just a few minutes talking about why I'm doing this particular video. I think our online coding environment is very effective. I know that I can support you in your learning and I'm able to either do a screen share like this where we're sharing your screen and help you along if we can work together at the same time, or you can give me read-write access to your REPL and I can come in and take a look, see what's going wrong, leave you some notes. And so even if we can't actually get together at exactly the same time, I can be of help, and I hope you'll let me be of help. This is the one exercise all semester where I really wish, instead of working like that, we could be in a room together and I could be looking over your shoulder while you code. I think when you first start coding in any environment, it's a little like a time, the only time I ever went winter camping with my really serious winter camping, like hang out in a tent in the snow with my husband. We headed up. It wasn't a huge adventure. It wasn't intended to be a huge adventure. We headed up a nice packed trail on a day when it was supposed to be light snow, and spent a good night in the tent. Got to melt a lot of snow into water and everything. But over the course of the night, it had snowed, in fact, more than a foot. So as we came down the same trail the next morning that we had gone up, we knew the trail was there. And as long as we were on the trail and putting one foot in front of each other and the trail didn't turn, it really wasn't hard walking. But if you stepped off even by a tiny bit to one side or the other, you post-holed down to your hips in snow, and then it was just plain hard to get out. And this is when you just start coding, it's easy to just take a little step off to one side or the other. And so I can't be there in the room with you when you're coding this first exercise. The next best thing I can think of is for you to be here with me while I walk through it. And trust me, I will make enough mistakes that I can talk you through some of the things that may happen to you. And so I'm going to turn off my camera and turn on my screen share and walk you through just a really abbreviated version of creating the Bistro application and also doing the validation, so you get a sense for what I'm talking about. So clicking the button now to share my browser, and clicking the button now to stop the video. Okay, so this is more like what we'll normally do, is that you're gonna be seeing either my whole screen, or you're gonna be seeing, as you are right now, just a window on my screen. And so I'm gonna go through these steps where I essentially create a new REPL, give it a name, clean the file up and the file folder up a little bit, and then just a couple of steps in terms of creating the page. So my cat, Winston, is letting me use his account once again. He's very cooperative that way. And Winston has a problem that he's always seeing this email, and I can't seem to get that to go away on a consensus basis. It'll go away for a while and come back. It doesn't seem to keep him from coding, so we're just going to go ahead and do a new REPL and choose HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, which by now has been made my Winston's favorite, and name this Bistro. And if we look at the directions here, I hope we don't lose that. We want the name to be Bistro, year, month, day, and approximate hour when we start the project. So Bistro 2020, yes, it is that new year. It is January. I'm making this on the 17th, and it's after lunch. So it's that deadly period when you're just about to fall asleep. So I'd rather talk to you than fall asleep. And here we are creating a new REPL. All right, so this is the same default code that you got the last time, which runs but has nothing in it. And we're gonna have it make it have even less of anything in it, okay? So the directions are delete the style.css and JavaScript files. We're just gonna clean up the environment. And then we're actually gonna delete the content that's in index.html. So I come over here and I want to delete this file, and there's a "Are you really sure?" button, and delete this one, and "Are you really sure?" And that doesn't actually keep the code from working in any particular way. If I have some text in my body, I can still see that come out over here. The sort of radical thing we're going to do, and you may resist this because I have some valid HTML in here and you feel like you're throwing away something valid, and it's kind of like throwing away the rope that's tying you to the boat. But this exercise is really only good if you start with a blank file. Okay. So, at this point, I can hit the run button. I don't think anything will fall down and die, but I won't see anything in my result file, in my result window, because there isn't anything for it to show. So, so you do not have to watch me fat finger type my way through this text. I actually have the text that is supposed to go into the body of this in step one over in another editor, and I'm just going to copy that in. Okay, and as you can see in my index.html, that looks as if it's formatted into basically into paragraphs, and the things that would become headings are on a line by themselves. And one reminder, don't try to delete index.html. REPL won't let you do it, so don't get frustrated trying. You always need to have each of your projects in REPL, in REPLet, have an index.html. So all I did was delete the lines out of it. I didn't delete the file. Now, if I run, what happens is that the web page engine, the browser engine, renders that into a web page. Okay. And what happens is the text all gets mushed together because white space, which is the technical term for things like new line characters and blank lines, is ignored by browsers. It simply isn't rendered. One of the things that many of us had to get used to a long time ago is that on a web page, you don't have two spaces after a period, which used to be the typesetting convention, that in fact after any period there would only be rendered a single space. And that's because extra white space beyond one single blank character is always ignored. So if I go in here and I type a bunch of empty spaces, we're going to see that there's still only one right here. And this doesn't change even if I hit this button. The only thing that's different here is that because there's more space in this actual browser window than there was in this result/preview pane, the lines wrap differently within the window. Okay, so if I went to validate this code at this point, which I hope none of you do because it can be alarming, but say I made a mistake and I tried to validate that right now. So I go to my validation page, okay, and this environment's kind of handy because I can validate the actual code straight from this URL. So if I carefully copy that web address and I put it right here, okay, and I push validate, I'm probably going to see a whole lot of errors. Okay. And actually, there are a lot fewer than I expected, but they're bright red and they could be alarming. So, among others, expected the doc tape type.html as the first part. So, don't do what I just did. Don't try to validate the page in this stage, okay? When you have enhanced this with the markup from the minimal version that is in the book, and I'm actually going to grab, that version of it too. It's not that much different, so... Okay, so if I replace this with what you should have after you have finished the, I think it's the dash two exercise that is, that creates what they call a minimal version, then you have a few things that are always required. There isn't actually a lot that is required to be a valid HTML page. It's just that anything you do have has to be done right. So this is required, and a title is required, and there really actually isn't a whole lot more. But what you'll see, and you won't see a lot difference in the rendering. So if I hit run now, I really don't see anything different over here because I haven't started to format what is in the body. What I will see is if I go over here and I hit refresh, I will see the title from this element show up in my tab. And the other thing I'd see if I started to validate at this point is if I go and I hit this validate button now, I get the fact that the document is valid HTML. And so, although it is only required for you to validate this page at the end of this exercise, I think it's just super useful for you to be trying to validate even at this point. It's just really easy to do things like, as you type, forget that when you have an open tag and a closed tag, that the closed tag needs to have a forward slash in it. And so if I have that, okay, lots of things start to go wrong here. But if I try to validate that, okay, I get one error message that doesn't make too much sense, and another that makes quite a bit of sense. It says unclosed element title. Okay, from line 6, column 1. So if I go back here and I look at line 6, my attention is called to the fact that that's the title element, and I think I've closed it, but then I realize I'm missing that slash, okay? And having made that one change, my code goes back to being valid. So you pretty much have to get to the point where you've got these lines and this typed in before it's useful to try to use the validator. But the validator is your friend. We're going to be insisting on producing valid results over the course of the next few weeks. And the I think the more vigorously you you work with the validator, the more often you both run your code to see the output and validate, the better off you are. Now, just to anticipate, I don't have the book in front of me. Do I have the book in front of me? Hang on, I think I do. It's on the desk. Let me go and do one more thing. Okay, so just to give you a sense of what happens next. I'm pretty sure, and please use the instructions in the book rather than what I'm doing here, because I'm sort of faking it. But this is an H1 heading, a major heading. So if I run at that point, voila, I'm suddenly getting some styling going on. And here, I think the book is saying that that should be an H2. So then if I run again, okay. Oh, that's not quite right because now everything here is being styled like a heading. Okay. You might want to use the validator at this point to give you a clue about what's going on. Okay. And again, we've got an unclosed element H2. I generally recommend starting at the top and seeing if you can understand what's going on. And I think actually you could. If you look at line 13, it's telling you that it's starting a new H2 inside a heading. And if we go back here, we can see that once again, I forgot to type that closing tag correctly. So if I put a slash there so that your browser knows that this is the start of the H2 heading and this is the end of it, I should both see better results and once again go back to having valid code. You don't have to validate every single change you make, but you will find that the more validation you do, you'll find a rhythm that works for you, is basically what it comes down to. So as you code this, be sure it's cheap to hit the run button, okay? Even you don't necessarily at this stage need to be looking at it in this separate browser window. You're not getting a lot more information from it there because everything fits nicely here. As we get more complicated, as we get to much more complex pages, bigger pages, you're definitely going to be wanting to look at them through this separate window. Right now, for the Bistro exercise, this preview should work well. So I hope that was helpful. I do requests. So if you find a terminology that I'm using that you don't understand, if you need help with downloading and uploading files, for example, it might be easier to do that one-on-one and actually help you on your machine because there are so many different combinations of operating system and browser. You know, like the fork video in this week, I think it's there are terms I'm going to use that just don't make sense. And if there's some way I can either do a slide or a vid to help you understand them, just let me know, because that's what I'm here for, is to help and to guide. And if we're not interacting, I can't really do either one of those. So good luck with the Bistro exercise. I still think it's just so cool when you take text that looks like this and then turn it into something that's a nicely formatted little web page. You're not using much markup, but it's remarkable how much you can do with even a little. And then we just get fancier and fancier as we go through the semester. Good luck.